joined us last week. Really an amazing program. Again, this is World Oregon's Great Decisions Series, and we're thrilled to be here at Portland State University. A big thanks to PSU for being our host, along with our sponsor, Kathy Moyd, who helps make the streaming portion possible, which, as with the snowstorm, became ever so important. But we continue to do with, you know, good balance of folks in the room and online. We have a great contingent here from St. Mary's High School, just around the corner. We're thrilled to have them here. So I'm going to leave it to Tim, our director of programs, to talk about some of the upcoming events we have and other items. And we're thrilled to have today's speaker, and Tim's going to tell you about our special connection to her. So without further ado, Tim will get us going. Again, welcome and thanks.
Thank you very much, Derek. Great to see you all back here. Hope you all survived the terrible torrential and calamitous blizzard. The New England-born and Midwest-raised speaker in front of you always scoffs at it, but I get it. It's a real thing. A couple things I wanted, of course, to welcome you back. Let you know that if you did miss one of our programs, we do have all of the previous Great Decisions programs on YouTube, on our on the World Oregon YouTube channel, and this one will be as well. We have two more after this. So if you can't make it in person, you can, of course, stream it live. And I think we have finally, thank you, Dave, and thank you, Campus AV team. I think we've finally gotten the thing just right. The other thing I want to mention is, if you don't have one of these yet, how many of you have one of these? Okay, if you do not have the Great Decisions book and you would like one, they retail for $35, but for you. Today. While supplies last, they are $28 and they may even go down. So we would be happy to sell you one. Another thing I keep talking to you about is I've been reading this fascinating book called Every Citizen a Statesman, and it is a history of the Foreign Policy Association and the development of great decisions, which Oregon plays a very, very major role in. As I talk incessantly about, the program was started here in Portland a very, very long time ago, back in the early 50s. And it is an amazing story to think about the investment that was made in lifelong learning and adult education, and the idea that we can remove citizen diplomacy and democracy from the elites and give it to all of you like we are here every Friday, year in and year out. So David Allen is the author. We're going to be doing a program with David Allen in April. It will be a virtual program. I don't have the date yet, but keep an eye out for that. I think it is an elegantly written book. His other gig is writing classical music reviews for the New York Times. And so he's pretty good at what he's doing. The other thing I wanted to tell you about is a program coming up called A World of Turmoil, the United States, China, and Taiwan in the Long Cold War. This is with author Stephen Hartnett, and we are presenting this online next Wednesday, March 8th. It is a co-presentation between the World Oregon and the Northwest China Council, one of our very longtime community partners, and that is on, you can go to nwcc.org, which is the Northwest China Council's website, and you can register for that. It should be a great conversation. It's a good follow-up to James Lin's talk a couple weeks ago here on the U.S. and China and the wedge of the Taiwan issue, which brings us to, we've got a couple more weeks left in this series. Next week, we have Robert Asadi, who has spoken for this series in the past and has spoken most recently for us on the protests in Iran that have been ongoing. And Robert is a fantastic thinker and speaker and writer on Iranian issues. He used to be here at PSU. He is now at Portland Community College, and he will be talking about Iran at a crossroads, and that will be in this room next week at noon. So I'm really excited today to have with us Becca Feathers and the topic of war crimes. I joke in my office, I'm always being teased because I am Mr. Doom and Gloom. War crimes, genocide, human trafficking, it is always sunny in Tim's office. but it is a very, very real issue, and it's certainly been brought to the fore with issues in Ukraine of reevaluating and looking at the framework. And I'm glad that we have somebody with the perspective of Becca Feathers with us today. She is a legal advisor on political development in conflict-affected states. Her writing is influenced by her work with clients and partners in more than a dozen countries, where she has helped to draft constitutions, design transitional governments, facilitate peace processes, and advocate for improved access to justice. She is a proud alumna of Lewis and Clark College, the Fletcher School of Law and Diplomacy, and American University's Washington College of Law. She lives with her talented, pun-loving wife and a suspiciously intelligent dog in Portland, Oregon. And she also was at one time an intern for the World Affairs Council of Oregon back in the Jeff Merkley days. The other thing is, she is the author of a really, really fantastic series. It is the World Citizens comic series, which is published by Macmillan. And I have here copies of a couple of her books. If you're very interested in them, you can get them from her here today. She can do that deal with you directly. But Why the People, The Case for Democracy, and Reconstitutions, Connecting Citizens with Rules of the Game. So without further ado, let me turn things over to Becca Feathers.
Thank you, Tim, and World Oregon. And in the spirit of accurate reporting, I have to note that I am one of the authors of the World Citizens comic series. It's an excellent series. It'll have about 12 books. In total, they are all nonfiction graphic novels about civics and governance, and I encourage you to check them out. So thank you all for being here today. I know that sometimes the great decisions topics can seem distant from Portland, but we can also watch the news and read the news and understand how they are relevant to many aspects of our daily lives. And it is extremely important for citizens, no matter where they are, to be thinking about these topics, because eventually they will impact your life directly or indirectly. So before we get started today, I just want to take a quick show of hands. Who here in the room has read the chapter? And there's no quiz, I promise. This is just so I know a little bit about how much detail to go into. Okay, great. So I'll sum up the chapter for you very briefly. We know that broadly, the legal concept of the war crime evolved through the late 19th and 20th centuries in the context of European wars of aggression and conquest. Eventually, the idea of war crimes were codified in a variety of conventions, the Geneva Convention, the Hague Conventions, the Genocide Convention, and then finally the Rome Statute that created the International Criminal Court. Okay, great. That's the dry, boring, but necessary factual legal history. And what I should tell you before I go any farther is that, as Tim said, I have a background working on transitional justice and political development and peace negotiations, which means that the perspective I bring today is the perspective of a lawyer who advises countries, governments, rebel groups, civil society organizations about these issues, not the perspective of a prosecutor or defender in war crimes trials. And there's an important distinction there. So that's the perspective I'm excited to share with you. Over the course of developing this idea of the war crime, and if you read the chapter, none of this part will be surprising to you, some key debates came up again and again. So one, what kind of acts will be permitted or prohibited, and against which kinds of people, combatants, civilians, so forth? Second, is the purpose of criminalizing those acts to make wars, which are inevitable, less terrible? Or is the purpose of criminalizing those acts to deter people from engaging in wars at all? And is it even possible to have something called a just war, or a war that's worth fighting? Third, who should be held accountable for committing these acts? The people whose hands actually commit the acts on the ground? The people who plan and strategize and give the orders? Both? Neither? And then finally, of course, the question of state sovereignty. To what degree should the sovereign right of a state to exist protect leaders from accountability for acts that the state commits or that they commit in the name of their state? So those are some of the big questions that drove the development of war crimes, and they're questions that we see playing out today in Ukraine. We think about
whether Putin can be held accountable, what is the responsibility of soldiers on the ground, and so forth. But it's not just Ukraine. And I know the framework for this course or this session was very much Ukraine, but also in Syria, in Sudan, in South Sudan, in Burma, previously in the Balkan states, in the Democratic Republic of the Congo, in Chile, in Rwanda, in Guatemala, across the world, these questions have been asked and answered to varying degrees. So the chapter gives a foundation here, and I hope I've given you enough to go on. But what I'd like to do today is sort of push beyond that to highlight some of the other key issues that I have seen in my practice and that I think are really the most relevant today. So the first thing, though, is let's talk about what we actually mean by war crimes. Because we say war crimes, but what we're actually talking about is mass atrocity crimes. War crimes are one category within a mass atrocity crime, and there are four main mass atrocity crimes. First, the big one is genocide. And these are all, I should say, defined to some extent by international law or convention or custom. So genocide is an act or acts designed to destroy in whole or in part an identifiable group. An identifiable can be a national group, an ethnic group, a racial group, a religious group, but some identifiable group. This includes killing, causing significant physical and mental harm, creating unsurvivable conditions, but it also includes things like preventing births or forcibly removing children from the group. This is the most serious mass atrocity crime and also often the most difficult to prove. Next, we have war crimes. These are generally found, and there are many, many nuances, so I'm not going to be able to give you just a list of war crimes today, but these are generally found in the Geneva and Hague Conventions, and they apply to both civilians and combatants. They can apply to wars between countries or wars within countries. And these are all about what is permitted in different contexts. So war crimes may include things like targeting civilians or civilian properties, like hospitals or schools or museums or churches. Includes the treatment of prisoners of war or people who have surrendered. So no torture, no cruel or inhumane imprisonment and so forth. And it also includes things like the use of different types of weapons. So you cannot use weapons that cause disproportionate destruction or wanton destruction. For instance, chemical or biological weapons that can't be restricted to solely military targets. Use of those is considered a war crime. The third category? Maybe.
Oh boy, is it not switching? We were having an issue with your slide not switching on the screen.
Interesting. So, all right.
And they were doing fine.
Well, the technology fights with itself. I'll keep going. So the third category is crimes against humanity, which is probably a phrase that you have heard before in connection with genocide and war crimes. The key difference is that crimes against humanity are targeted against civilians, and they are acts committed as part of a, quote, widespread or systematic attack against civilian populations. So some of the same acts count here, right? Murder, torture, rape and sexual violence. When used as a weapon against a group or a large group of people, including forced prostitution or forced sterilization, these are crimes against humanity. Apartheid and acts of apartheid are crimes against humanity. And any other acts that intentionally cause great suffering or injury to a large number of people. And that's the key with crimes against humanity is a large number of people. The fourth category is ethnic cleansing. This is not formally codified in law, but has come to be understood as adjacent to a war crime, and it is essentially forcible removal of a group of people, a group of ethnic people from an area using force, violence, and intimidation. So those are the four big categories that we're talking about when we talk about mass atrocity crimes. I have the next slide. All right, let's see. Haha. All right, great. All right, so this is an example of how we can see these legal classifications playing out on the daily news stage, because that was all a lot of sort of dry legal stuff. This is the formal determination of war crimes released by the State Department a couple of weeks ago, finding that Russian officials and the Russian government had perpetrated war crimes in Ukraine.
This follows a similar determination in March of 2022 that found that Russian soldiers had committed war crimes in Ukraine. This is about the leadership and the planners and the executors. So you can see some of the same language here. I've highlighted here widespread and systematic attack because that's really critical legal language. But you can see the sorts of acts they're talking about: killing civilians, torture and detaining civilians, rape, deporting Ukrainian children to Russia. So this statement is pulling on the international legal definitions to justify whatever the United States may choose to do in the future to address war crimes. And what the United States may choose to do in the future is an open question and worth debating here and elsewhere. So the question that we have from here is, once we have understood what war crimes are, once we have done some investigation and decided that they're happening, or mass atrocity crimes are happening, what do we do? The chapter that you read focuses quite heavily on prosecution. So the Nuremberg trials after World War II, the ICTY and the ICTR, the International Criminal Tribunals for Yugoslavia and Rwanda, and of course the International Criminal Court, the ICC. And that's one facet, but it's really only one of many options, because prosecutions and trials are only one small part of the ecosystem of what we call transitional justice, which is an approach to trying to provide justice following large-scale conflict or political upheaval where mass atrocity crimes and human rights violations have been committed. So, magical disappearing title. All right. So transitional justice typically has four dimensions. One is accountability, and that's where you'll find things like trials, prosecutions, tribunals. This is the International Criminal Court, very formal. But accountability can also mean lustration or vetting, which means that people who are accused of committing mass atrocity crimes or particular human rights violations might be excluded from serving as high government officials. They might not be allowed to join the military or the police force or the security services. Accountability is focused on the perpetrators. Finding the perpetrators, proving what they have done, and having some sort of penalty or punishment, whether that's criminal or otherwise. The second dimension of transitional justice is truth-telling. This is very victim-focused and community-focused. And the idea behind truth-telling, that's different from accountability, is what you want at the end is some sort of comprehensive narrative of what happened that everyone involved can agree is the quote-unquote true history. The purpose here is to both give victims an opportunity to speak, to stand up and say, this happens to me, this happens to my brother, this happened to my family, this happens to my village or my community, to be heard and to have that go into some sort of formal record so that later no one can say, oh no, no, those massacres didn't happen. No, 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 those detention centers were exaggerated. Truth-telling is to get all of that out so that it's understood and acknowledged. It is also often a less adversarial process than an accountability process. The third dimension is memorialization. This can be literal, actual, we've built a memorial to this massacre. It can also mean having a particular holiday or adding a color to a flag to recognize, an historically marginalized or oppressed people. It can also take on a much more tangible aspect. And I put this picture up here. This is the South African Constitutional Court in Johannesburg. It is built on the site of a notorious prison where many, many anti-apartheid activists were held in solitary confinement, were tortured, were unjustly detained. Not only is the Constitutional Court built on that site, and elements of the prison are retained there as a museum, but the bricks that you see in the back wall of this main chamber of the Constitutional Court are actually the same bricks from the prison that was torn down in its spot. So this is a very tangible, the past is different from the future. We've taken the symbol of injustice and we've rebuilt it into a symbol of justice. So that can be an aspect of memorialization, which is almost always communally focused. And then the final dimension is reparations. And there are too many possible reparations to list here. So these are just some of the goals of reparations, but it can be anything from payments to compensate for losses of property or livelihoods or health. It can be actual provision of services. mental, physical, psychosocial services to help victims recover. It could be including particular histories or languages in educational curricula. It could be commissioning works of art or documents from representatives of the victim group. But the difference between reparations and memorialization is that reparations are deeply, deeply individually victim focused. Meeting the victims where they are, the victims' families where they are, and figuring out what they need to move forward and feel, if not restored, at least somewhat rehabilitated. So this gives you a sense of how much bigger the idea of responding to mass atrocities can be than just prosecutions. And that's really important because when we talk about mass atrocity crimes, we really have to think about all four of these dimensions, in part because there are often too many perpetrators to prosecute. Trials are expensive. They take a long time. They're fundamentally adversarial. And so if what you're trying to support is a process towards reconciliation and healing, a trial is not always the best or only way to do that. Often countries that have experienced mass atrocities have limited infrastructure and resources to support a trial. So maybe some other mechanism is a good supplement to that. Victims often need more than a trial. Sometimes they do want to see the person who did what, you know, who caused their harm experience justice in a courtroom, but sometimes they want that and something else. Or maybe sometimes a trial isn't what they mean by justice, particularly in non-Western countries that have more communal concepts of justice than we do. Transitional justice is also about collectively processing a mass trauma, which is not necessarily something that you can do purely through trials. And then finally, responding to mass atrocities, or the process of responding to mass atrocities, is setting a pattern for what you're going to do in the future, how you're going to react to both this kind of crime in the future, but also how you're going to treat the victims, how you're going to treat the perpetrators in the future. And so we need to think about that when we think about what mechanisms we use. And I want to emphasize here that none of these are a zero-sum game. You don't have to choose just trials or just truth-telling or just build a memorial and call it a day. You can build all of these things into a system together, and the international community often has a role to play in all of them. So when we think about which mechanisms are best, there are some factors that we should consider. And as I go through these, I'd really love you to be thinking about what you know about Ukraine, or if there is another case study that is particularly relevant to you, El Salvador or Honduras or Chile or South Africa, South Sudan, whatever is speaking to you or whatever you happen to know something about, think about these particular factors. So the first is, what is the scope of response we're thinking about? And I mean scope in time, right? What period of time are we thinking? For instance, the International Criminal Court has opened up an investigation into Ukraine. They're looking at crimes committed between 2013 and now. So not just the last year when Russia was actively invading Eastern Ukraine and bombing Kyiv, but also all the way back to the annexation of Crimea. That's a pretty big scope. Defining that scope determines in part who can be a perpetrator and what acts they might be held accountable for. What kinds of acts qualify? So what is your substantive scope? This has a practical consideration. If you're doing trials, you need to know what crimes are possible crimes, what evidence would you need to collect, what would you need to prove. If you're doing reparations, you need to know what kinds of victims or what things victims could have suffered that they would be eligible for reparations in response to. Or perhaps the acts that were committed make you eligible for different aspects of transitional justice. So in South Africa, for instance, for some perpetrators who had committed less serious acts, they could go before the Truth and Reconciliation Commission and confess what they had done and share information about, you know, if they knew where bodies were buried or something, documents were hidden, then they could receive amnesty. But perpetrators of serious acts, the planners and executors of apartheid, they could never qualify for amnesty. It didn't matter how much truth they told. They were held accountable by trials. There are also political considerations here, right? None of these decisions get made in a political vacuum. So one example I'll just throw out for you, who was tried at Nuremberg after World War II? German officials. But Americans also interned people during World War II. And they were not tried at Nuremberg. That was a political decision. And that's far from the only example in that particular vein. Another factor to consider is where will the mechanism be located? So if you're having your trials or your truth-telling mechanism or something in country, then you're very close to where things happened, but you might also be in a dangerous situation. If you're holding a trial, it could become a focal point for violence, or there might not be the infrastructure to have a trial safely. And I'm not just talking about, you know, is there a courtroom, although I am talking about that, or is there electricity in the courtroom, but is there a prison capable of holding people who are convicted? Is there a way to keep defendants and witnesses safe? Sometimes there's not. And so you think about, well, let's move the trials out of country, you know, to The Hague or to Europe or somewhere where everything is already set up for them. So then the risk there is you've taken the justice out of the country. You've taken the justice away from the victims and the people who witnessed the atrocities. And then they're not connected, or they are, you know, they're open to misinformation about what's happening at the trial. So those are considerations to keep in mind. Another factor to think about is who will pay. I've said these are really expensive. They are so expensive. I cannot articulate to you how expensive they are. That cost is almost certainly going to be borne by the international community. So whether that's the US and the UK, Canada, whether it's a regional power, you know, if the EU steps in, somebody's going to bear that cost. And that's a cost of money and time and human resources, but also in attention. You know, there's a pretty heavy cost of who's paying attention and for how long. And then the next factor here is how do you collect evidence for trials or for any other aspect of war crimes, or excuse me, of mass atrocity crimes. But I'm gonna focus on trials here because trials have a different standard of evidence. And when we talk about collecting evidence for war crimes, imagine you're trying to collect evidence of the Syrian government using gas on civilians, using white phosphorus on civilians. So the options you have are to use the cell phone videos of civilians who were there or who might have been there and figure out some way to verify those. You can go and embed yourself in Syrian towns and villages and wait for the government to drop white phosphorus on you. You can try to get documentation from the Syrian government, you know, through somebody who feels guilty about what's happening and is willing to sneak it out to you, or by breaking into Syrian government archives. There are lots of options and none of them are great, but the thing you have to think about is how do we get the evidence? How do we maintain a chain of custody so we know that this is real evidence that was accurately collected? And then how do we get it to the people who can prosecute the crime? And I know Tim will be sending out some resources after this to read. I've included in there one article specifically about the Syrian Justice and Accountability Center, which innovated a lot of new and really, really brave techniques to do this that are now being used in Ukraine. And you may or may not know this, but one of this year's Nobel Peace Prize winners is the Center for Civil Liberties in Ukraine, which does this work in Ukraine based on what they learned from Syrian and other activists. So this is something that is largely being done today by civilians, by people who just live in their communities and neighborhoods who see terrible things happening and find a way to document and share that information in the hopes that someday somebody will hold the perpetrators accountable. The last thing I want you all to be thinking about today is what is the purpose of responding to mass atrocity crimes? Why do we do it? I'm not gonna make anybody answer right now, but is it to punish bad people who do bad things and prevent them from doing bad things in the future? Okay, maybe that's why we use trials. But then you have to make sure you get the folks at the top and not just the folks on the ground, right? And you know, we can look around the world and think to ourselves, all right, we've put a lot of people on trial. Have we deterred other people from doing those bad things again? Is the purpose to give justice to victims? And in that case, how do we make sure we know what the victims think of as justice? How do we make sure we know what the victims need? How do we make sure we're keeping them centered in our thoughts and our planning? And that's something that takes a lot of attention and a lot of time and a lot of foundational knowledge before you can get started. Is the purpose to facilitate reconciliation and build a future peace? Okay, then you have to think bigger, right? You can't just think about what does this victim need or what does this village need? but what can bring all these groups that have been fighting together? What can make marginalized groups feel like they have been rehabilitated or restored? How can you balance the different competing forces in society without restarting a conflict? So that's, these are not easy questions at all, but these are the factors that sit behind every decision about mass atrocities. And then on top of all of that is the issue of political will and sovereignty. So the principle of sovereignty states that all states have the ability to control what happens within their borders and to make decisions for themselves and cannot be held accountable by other states. But when states are committing the atrocities, who can hold them, you know, when leaders are committing the atrocities, who can hold them accountable except other states? And to what extent should we protect leaders from that? So I know I've just given you a lot of information, and I know that the chapter itself has some questions for you to think and talk about, and I wanna make sure we have time for questions here, but I wanted to leave you with a few additional questions to ponder. So first, who is being served by accountability mechanisms and who are the intended beneficiaries of justice? When we deliver tribunals, are we doing it so that the state of Chile can feel like it did something? Or are we doing it so that the mothers of the disappeared find out, you know, can get justice for what happened to their sons? If one of the purposes of prosecuting mass atrocity crimes is to deter war, how are we doing on that front? And finally, to what extent should state sovereignty shield people, particularly planners of mass atrocities? And what is the benefit we get from giving leaders who might plan mass atrocities some shield? Are we able to negotiate with them more effectively in some other arena? Are we able to get them to cease the atrocity sooner if we promise that they won't be prosecuted? What are the trade-offs, and who and what is state sovereignty protecting? So I will stop there and open it up to questions. And Tim, I'm hoping you will guide us through this process.
I will do my darndest. So I'm gonna start with a couple things that are actually in the Great Decisions book, because I think they're things that we sit and mull over a lot, which is, I'm gonna do kind of a two-part question here. Are rulings by international courts valuable even if they have no enforcement mechanisms of their own? And then I'm thinking about the UN Security Council and the ability for people on the council to veto the involvement of decision-making in that process. So on the one hand, are these rulings valuable? The other is, do the mechanisms we have need to be reconsidered?
Sure. So I'll answer the second question first, because really these are questions about accountability. Who can be held accountable, and who gets to decide who can be held accountable? So when we think about the UN Security Council and the permanent five members, of which Russia is one, those permanent five members have a veto over actions of the UN Security Council. The UN Security Council gets to decide in part who is tried before the International Criminal Court. They aren't the only deciders, but they have a role. So if Russia has a permanent veto on the UN Security Council, and Russia is looking at having some of its senior government officials potentially tried or at least charged by the International Criminal Court, what incentive does Russia have to agree to allow the International Criminal Court to have jurisdiction? None, right? But at the same time, if there is a leader in another country who is thinking or planning mass atrocities in their own country, what incentive do they have then to either befriend permanent members of the Security Council or themselves get themselves placed on the Security Council as a shield from accountability? Okay, so that's the depressing answer to, do we need to rethink our institutions? And I have no good response to you for that, because the only mechanism we have to change our institutions is to have those who are currently in positions of power vote to change the institutions. The flip side of that is that the International Criminal Court didn't appear because everyone suddenly decided that mass atrocity crimes were bad and we will never do them again. It was the process of 100 years of fighting for some level of accountability for senior leaders. And in spite of powerful leaders at every stage, including in the US, resisting the development of that court, it came to be, and it has prosecuted high-level criminals, including heads of state. So there is an impact even when there's no incentive for leaders to be, excuse me, for the permanent five members of the Security Council to authorize further ICC action, or when they don't like the possible outcomes of the trials. And one of the impacts, both at the ICC and in the international criminal tribunals that have been held in other regions, is to establish principles of how we regard these atrocity crimes. So I'll give you two examples. One is that it was through the ICTY in Yugoslavia that we established the principle of command and control. So the idea that you cannot just say, oh, I was just following orders. And you also can't say, oh, well, I wasn't the person who carried out the bad acts on the ground. I didn't carry out the massacre. You can't hold me accountable. It was through that trial and the evidence collected that we were able to establish a principle that if you are a planner of a mass atrocity, you can be held accountable. It was only through the transitional justice and accountability efforts in Rwanda and the Democratic Republic of the Congo that we established the principle that rape is used as a weapon of war, and that we should try rape as a weapon of war, as a war crime. And so the trials have an impact, the rulings have an impact, even when they don't have an enforcement mechanism. Do I personally think they would have more impact if they had an enforcement mechanism? Absolutely. But that's true at every level, not just at the international court level.
Great, thanks. We are going to, as we've done before, alternate questions in the room and questions online. So if you have a question in the room, let me know. Remember, questions have to be on mic with no back and forth with the speaker, because it makes it very hard for the Zoom participants to hear. Tim, if you have one queued up, and then raise your hand.
Yes, I've got a couple online here. And Becca, I believe you sort of answered one that came in, but I'm gonna ask it again. This is from Vim Vivel. Some of you may know him in this room. He says, can you elaborate a little further on the legal theories and practical issues regarding the culpability of actual perpetrators who may have limited choices versus that of those who gave the orders?
Sure. So that question has a variety of answers depending on the context. So what I can say first is that there is an established principle that not every perpetrator has the same level of control over the decisions that they make. They don't have the same ability to refuse, and they don't have the same ability to design or decide the scope of the acts that they commit. And that's part of the reason that this universe of transitional justice is really important to think about. And I'll give you an example out of Uganda, actually. So in Uganda, particularly in northern Uganda, there was a multi-decade conflict both between the government and separatist groups, and also between armed factions in northern Uganda. And at the end of which, there were many, many former combatants who had been compelled, conscripted to join. And many of them had been conscripted as children. And so there's a question about what level of complicity does a child soldier have in committing terrible acts? They indisputably committed terrible acts. They were also indisputably forced to do that in many circumstances, or they were kidnapped so young and indoctrinated that they didn't really have the ability to think about an alternative way of being or living. And so one of the more successful examples of transitional justice incorporating local methods was used in northern Uganda, where a local healing and reconciliation ceremony was adopted as a way of giving former child soldiers a way to acknowledge that they had committed wrongs in a community and to talk about the wrongs that they had committed, give the community and the victims' families opportunities to speak back and say what had happened to them and how it had affected them, and then start a process of reintegration and reconciliation in those communities. Now, I know that's not exactly the legal question you're asking there, but one of the things that process did in northern Uganda was remove a whole swath of people who were not at the same level of complicity as planners and leaders from the justice system, from potentially being imprisoned first for years before their trials even came up, and then afterwards in conditions that are frankly inhumane. So So that's the example I like to share, because it shows that there are ways to integrate these two or these multiple dimensions of transitional justice productively. I don't know that there is a clearly defined principle at the highest levels of international law or international customary law about the complicity of people who have been compelled to act. And in part, that's because the mechanisms that we have for trying those cases and for establishing those principles of law have largely focused on higher level perpetrators who have more agency.
Okay, we got a question in the room over here.
Thank you for your presentation. Great, actually. I'm sure the U.S. has been robust in support of much of this effort. And yet we've taken the position that our military won't be subject to these legal norms. And just a further thought along that, where is a definition developing or a precept developing around some of the drone warfare, drone and extrajudicial activity associated with that? Thank you.
Sure, that's a great question that unfortunately I'm not going to be able to answer for you, because the legal regime around use of drones is at this point, unfortunately, quite separate from the conversation about legal accountability for mass atrocity crimes. And that's a valid debate to have about whether it should be separate. One thing I'd like to highlight, though, is that within the statutes of the International Criminal Court, and I think that the questioner is referencing the fact that the United States has not become a member of the International Criminal Court, in part because it is afraid that American soldiers will be tried for activities committed abroad. One of the key precepts in the Rome Statute is that the jurisdiction of the International Criminal Court only applies to cases where the parent nation of the defendant is either unwilling or unable to provide an adequate trial at home for that sort of crime. The U.S. is absolutely able to try people for committing crimes abroad, and has done so. Whether the U.S. is willing to do that in all cases is debatable, but by and large, the U.S. is willing to do that. Fundamentally, that means that no American case at this time will come before the International Criminal Court. And so this is where I point you back to this question of, to what extent should state sovereignty shield perpetrators and planners of mass atrocity crimes? Should the International Criminal Court decline to prosecute in cases where a state might be able but unwilling, or able and willing but just hasn't yet? And to what extent should the U.S.'s fear of a possible future hypothetical prosecution, even though legally there's not really a way that an American would get into the ICC, to what extent should that drive American resistance to participating in international accountability efforts?
So we have a question from somebody online. In a recent interview with The New Yorker's David Remnick, Stephen Kotkin of Stanford University said that Zelensky defined Ukrainian victory as A, regaining all terrain, B, reparations, and C, war crime tribunals. The problem, Kotkin said, was that in order to achieve these goals, Ukraine must take Moscow. And can you comment on this?
I hope you're not asking me to assess whether Ukraine can take Moscow. I don't think it's necessary for Ukraine to conquer Russia in order to get justice for what Russia has done in Ukraine. And the evidence is that argument, I think, comes personally from a very World War II perspective of, well, we took Berlin, and so we got justice for what the Germans did. And in some cases, that has been the only way to get justice, but it is not the only way. The reason that we have international affairs, that international coalitions are important, that the international community has value, is because of the power of collective action. And so certainly in order to get justice for Ukraine from Russia, Russia will need to be in a position where they feel like they have no choice but to make concessions and to give. But there are many ways to negotiate that without physically occupying Moscow or without unmaking Russia as a state.
A question from a St. Mary's student in the room.
I had a question about the U.S. and how, like, because they've committed, I think, lots of war crimes, but they committed war crimes against Native American people and other people, but they don't seem to, I mean, I guess those were committed before these, war crime laws were put in place, but, like, will America ever be held accountable, or has America ever been held accountable for the war crimes they commit?
That is an excellent question. And the first thing I'll say in response to that is the Geneva Conventions, the Hague Conventions, the Genocide Convention, these were all developed primarily by European thinkers in European countries thinking about wars that happened in Europe and were perpetrated by and experienced by Europeans. When these principles were being debated in the late 19th century and the early 20th century, when the great legal thinkers were thinking about what is a war of aggression and what is a just war, they were not thinking about the Americas, about Africa, about Asia, where wars of aggression were being committed constantly and mass atrocities were being committed constantly. They did not think of those at the same level. And we know why. I can't speak to whether these conventions could be retroactively applied in a trial, but there's no statute of limitations on reparations or on truth telling or on memorials or the other aspects of transitional justice. There is no reason that the United States could not choose to, or in the future be compelled to by an international coalition, acknowledge the crimes that it has committed in its past history and make some sort of reparation for them. That is a very, very political decision. It's not, unfortunately, there is no power for a lawyer to come to Washington, D.C. and say, look, I've documented all the stuff you did, and it is time for you to be held accountable. And because if that were the case, lawyers for formerly enslaved people, lawyers for Indigenous Americans would have shown up a long time ago. Lawyers for Chinese and Asian immigrants denied citizenship and a number of other categories as well. But there is always a space to apply these other dimensions of transitional justice and then to try to build a more reconciliation-focused future from there.
So I'm wondering if you can talk about, in recent years, we've seen, you know, a weakening of liberal democracies. We've seen institutions like fact-based journalism challenged, certainly a rise of exceptionalism in the U.S. How are these things threatening or making it more difficult to really look at accountability in moving these crimes forward?
Sure. The idea that leaders should be accountable to their people for their actions is a deeply democratic idea. And to the extent that liberal democracy becomes weaker and the institutions that support liberal democracy then become weaker, we are less and less capable of holding leaders accountable for what they do to their people. So that is the first answer. The second answer is that in spite of generally receding democratic norms and principles, we have so many examples in Syria, in Hong Kong, in the color revolutions, in Sudan, of citizens standing up and reclaiming those rights, even when their governments or institutions are not interested in defending them or in acknowledging them. And what, so for instance, what we know about the crimes of the Syrian government, almost exclusively comes from Syrian civil society organizations that formed after the Syrian, after the Arab Spring began. These are small groups of people, and I had the privilege of working with some of them back in 2015, small groups of people, people who knew each other from college, people who knew each other just from the neighborhood, people who just began to collect what they saw and document it. And that is now the basis of any future prosecution for Syrian government officials. Will that happen or not at the international level? I don't know. But that evidence has been collected. It has been acknowledged by international lawyers and prosecutors as valuable evidence that can and should be used. And that is entirely citizen-driven. The advocacy efforts to keep that sort of information in public awareness, that's also citizen-driven. And so what I take from that is that the future institutions of liberal democracy are being formed now. They're maybe not being formed in the United States or in Canada, but they're being formed and they're being fought for and they're being defined.
Great, we have time for a couple more questions. We're going to two in the room and then back online.
Hi. There is a big argument within the community about two things. One is whether you're allowed to give impunity to anyone. And that especially came up when I was involved with Chile and Argentina, and also in some of the Central America cases. The second question is there's been an attempt to develop a duty to intervene. And if one looks at it, and from my own experience, both the, you know, across South America, Africa, Asia, and even in the States, it's applied in a very political way, in which there's a huge criticism that it's really used as an excuse to pierce sovereignty when Western countries want to pierce sovereignty. And it's really hypocritical. And it challenges the whole framework that we've developed and talked about. Could you comment on those two issues?
Sure. So the issue of impunity is a huge one. The UN actually formally recommends in peace negotiations that negotiators and mediators never put impunity on the table. They basically should, the UN recommends, never say, well, if you sign this peace agreement, you know, we will put in a clause that says you, the leaders, cannot be held accountable for your past actions. And the reason that they say that is because almost always people who have impunity for their past actions will feel free to commit them again. And I think that's very well grounded in history. And in fact, the alternative argument, of course, is that, well, then they won't come to the table. If leaders feel like they'll be held accountable for their actions, then they simply won't come to the table. And that's perfectly valid. The question I'd like to leave you with is, what level of impunity would be an acceptable level of impunity to end a conflict that is killing many, many more people than the one person who might end up being imprisoned? And how do you balance that against the chance of that one leader or those few leaders just waiting, rearming, and restarting the conflict again? And it's just an incredibly difficult question. And I think personally that needs to be a case-by-case decision. You need to look at individual conflicts and try to decide what is most effective there. And then your second question, I'm sorry, just remind me very briefly. The duty to intervene.
Duty,
yes,
intervene.
Yes, or the responsibility to protect is the legal principle. It is a legal principle that says that leaders in every country in the world have the responsibility to uphold the universal human rights of their citizens, and that if they are committing acts that violate the rights of their citizens, that count as mass atrocity crimes, then the international community has the legal duty to intervene and prevent that. And in fact, it has almost always, but not exclusively, been used when Western countries see an advantage to intervening. The counterbalance of that is, it is never used in cases where mass atrocities are not occurring. So, do we selectively intervene? Yes. Would our deterrence impact be greater if we always intervened? Almost certainly. When we intervene, we are stopping mass atrocities. So, where I come down on that is that there's a lot of progress to be made to build an international consensus on the duty to intervene and the responsibility to protect, and that both of those efforts are heavily dependent on the idea of the international system as something that Western countries and powerful countries would like to preserve, as opposed to tack on as a veneer to things that they're already doing.
Got another question from a St. Mary's student in the room.
Hi, I have a follow-up to your mention on the Eurocentrism of the UN and these indictments in general, and also to like cite a modern example, the level of international attention to the genocide in Myanmar versus the Rohingya genocide in Myanmar versus the war crimes in the Ukraine. Do you see an outsized impact on like European countries compared to Asian or African countries of these, I don't know what you would call them, like the statements that the UN Council puts out?
I think it's impossible to follow the news of mass atrocities in the world over the last, well, over any period of history, but particularly the last 5 or 10 years, and not see that there is a discrepancy between the coverage of Ukraine and the coverage of the Rohingya, or the coverage of the Sudanese, or Afghans, or Yemenis. Yes, there absolutely is a discrepancy. Sometimes that discrepancy has other factors associated with it. So in some cases, and I think Ukraine is actually a really good example, there was a robust civil society that existed in Ukraine at the time that Russia invaded, that was English speaking, that was media savvy, that was social media literate, and was prepared to educate the world. And their messages were received more favorably and seen by more people because of Eurocentrism, because of preferences for particular regions of the world. I do not want to ascribe racial implications to any particular recipient of messages, because I know plenty of people who are working on many, many different mass atrocity crimes who are also quite focused on Ukraine. And part of the reason they're quite focused on Ukraine is because they think they can use the momentum from people caring about Ukraine because it is in Europe, and because the victims look like people that in the US we can look around and see, as a way to establish essential legal principles for future mass atrocity crimes. But yes, there is a discrepancy in both attention and resources.
So one last question. You talked about accountability, and you talked about truth telling. And I mean, I think in the popular imagination, we think about Nuremberg trials or Eichmann in Jerusalem, or I think of, you know, Rwanda. Is there any, they're not mutually exclusive necessarily, but is there any prevailing sense that an internal transitional justice works better than an accountability system that is superimposed? And what's the conversation in the field you work in?
Sure. So I think the consensus, as I perceive it right now, is we understand that there is a role for trials. And the role for trials is usually the highest level planners, the highest level perpetrators, people who were responsible for the most egregious acts. Because we know the trials get the most attention, and we want to make sure that we focus that attention on the worst perpetrators, and in order to show that they are receiving justice. But that you supplement those trials then with other mechanisms, with Truth and Reconciliation Commissions, with reparations programs at the same time, both to help show on the ground in places where mass atrocities have occurred that justice doesn't just mean the things we can put on TV, but also how we can meaningfully change things on the ground. And I would say that there is a growing recognition, although I wouldn't yet say a consensus, that you get more long-term reconciliation sustainability out of reparations than you get out of large-scale trials. We also are struggling very much with the idea of how to do truth telling in a way that is time-bound and sensitive to the trauma that victims and participants in truth-telling mechanisms suffer, but that also delivers actionable recommendations in the future and enforceable recommendations in the future. And I don't think that that's something that we've resolved yet.
Let's have a big hand for Becca Feathers. For everyone in the room, some of the resources and articles that Becca mentioned, I'm going to send out an email on Monday as a follow-up to everyone who's in the room. Just if you want to read a little bit more, it's a great way to walk out. I hate to use the word armed with knowledge to try and make the world a little bit better. Becca, thanks for a really fantastic presentation. She does have the books that she is co-author of for sale if you'd like to check them out. It's a very, very cool series. And we will see you here next week. Thanks.